Hello, my people. It's Robb Scott of that relationship podcast, you know, that I do with my wife. Well, she's not here presently because she doesn't want to do too many of these. So I'm going to do some things on my own while she's away and she doesn't know about it. Just like all the other stuff I do behind her back that she doesn't know about. I thought today I'd do some Dear Abby questions. I would go to DearAbby.com and I would illegally take her questions from her website
and make them my own.
What do you think about that?
Take that, Dear Abby.
So, I got some questions. I didn't look at the answers. I'm just providing my own. And I picked a few. We'll see how it goes. So this is like more, think of this as a Q&A session. And you're going to learn a lot. So clean out your ear holes and let's get going. Dear Abby, I know you provide a booklet to help teens with questions about sex. But when should I talk to my son or give him a copy? He'll be 9 soon. I know that's young, but kids today, they're exposed to so much so early. Kristen in Maryland. Kristen, don't be afraid to talk to your kids. They're 9 years old. They've seen more stuff than any of us could imagine, probably, if they have a phone or if their friend has a phone. They're looking stuff up, for sure. I mean, how many times have you been on the internet and accidentally come across stuff you didn't want? That happens all the time on YouTube. They're seeing stuff at school at 9 years old. They're hearing stuff. What's that one? If a girl gets on top and you come, you can't get her pregnant because she's on top. Like, it'll just drip out. Kids like that believe that sort of shit. So you're going to let their friends be their source of wisdom? No, you got to go and talk to them about it. So you know what? I'm gonna talk to my kid right after this. When he comes home, I'm going to just blast him. I'll say, son, stop playing with your birdie around your mother and your father. It'll give you pimples. So if you don't talk to your kids soon, around 9, enjoy their gonorrhea at 15, okay? Dear Abby, I've observed and experienced that people won't tell you about a husband's or wife's infidelity while you or your spouse are together. However, they will reveal it after a divorce or death. What purpose does that serve? If people don't want to get involved, then allow me to make a suggestion. Send an unsigned letter in the mail with no return address. There are also phone features that let a person place an anonymous call. Call the workplace of the cheated spouse if you don't have his or her cell phone number. However, you can give the person as much information as you know. If you do, maybe a marriage can be saved or a spouse won't have to deal with an STD. Do you have an opinion, Abby? Strictly anonymous. I mean, the whole idea is tricky. Because if I was being cheated on, I would want to know. You don't want to keep being with somebody who's sleeping around on you. But I look at the world like this. People in general are attracted to what they need from their own souls, let's say. So, for example, I'm a very detailed, laid out, planned person. And my wife is very spontaneous and very unplanned and unstructured. You know, we seek what we don't have within us many times. We want to fill that hole or find someone who has a trait we know we don't have. But that also works for people who grew up in abuse and have not been able to let that go, and that feels like that's all they deserve when they get into future relationships is abuse, so they find abusers without even consciously knowing they're seeking out abusers. You know, within a relationship, it takes two people. I don't ever believe just one person was just a queen or a king that did everything they could and their spouse cheated on them. I'm sure that happens sometimes, but I don't think that's the rule. You know, if my wife cheated on me, I could look back at a whole list of things that I did that could cause that to come about. Now, thankfully, I don't think she has the interest to do that. I don't have the interest to do that even if I'm in an unhappy relationship and times the relationship is unhappy. Most people, you know, probably don't want to go outside. I'd rather end the marriage than just cheat on her. So I think when you have a situation where you've been cheated on, you're part of the problem. It's been a breakdown over time, for the most part, unless you get like somebody who's a serial cheater, but you know what? If they're a serial cheater, you probably knew that at some point. You saw signs and you ignored the signs and you got with them. So I don't know if I should feel bad about it. I don't know if I should feel bad for you. I think there's responsibility on both sides. Would I tell somebody I knew they were being cheated on? Probably. If it's somebody I loved, somebody I cared for. Yeah, for certain I would. You know, if there's somebody that I barely know and I know they're being cheated on, am I going to send them an anonymous message? I don't know, because I don't know if it's my business. But you could say, I guess, that also, well, the person that you love, it's not your business either. And maybe you're right. But there's a different connection, and I guess I'm not out to save the world. I'm out to save the people that I love and care for. So I don't know if that makes me a hypocrite as well. But I'm going to move on. Dear Abby, when I was 13 and 14, I sent nude pictures to guys I didn't know over Kik. K-I-K. I don't know what that is. I guess it's a photo sharing site. Maybe it's a misspelling. I'm now 15 and interested in a career in education. I have read about educators getting fired for sending pictures. Should I be worried that I will never have a career in education or get into a good college? Questioning teen. A good college? I doubt it. I mean, most adults understand that 13 and 14-year-olds only have half a brain and they won't hold it against you when you're 21, 22 years old. We've all done stupid things. I'm glad I wasn't born in this age of the internet going through my early teens, because I would have been crazy. But it also depends, you know, what you're doing in those pictures. If you're standing in front of a counter naked and the counter is full of cucumbers and bananas, you might have a different problem, if you get what I'm saying. Whether you should or you shouldn't, I don't know, but that's just how society is. They're going to judge you more harshly if you're doing graphic things within the photo, even at 13 or 14 years old. But if you're just nude, you know, your biggest worry is probably just embarrassment down the road. You know, I mean, it's on the internet forever. You probably find yourself someday popping up somewhere on Pornhub.com or some site. That's probably your biggest issue. If you're just nude in your pictures, I don't see how when you're 21, 22 years old and you're trying to, get your first job or get off the ground, it's going to have a whole lot of effect on you. Hopefully nobody sees it. Hopefully you're... Well, I don't know what this Kik is. K-I-K. I don't... You know, can anybody see that? Or is that just your... You know, if your boyfriend's a dick, did he share it with other people? That's your biggest worry, I guess. But yeah, stop sending naked pictures of yourself through the internet. Dear Abby, I have a 6-year-old son who is a very compassionate child. My husband's mother lives with us and recently went through an illness from which she recovered. Twice my son tried to give her a necklace he had made from braided yarn to cheer her up. Abby, she not only refused to accept them, but left them on the floor as if she didn't even want to touch them. She has no reason to dislike my son, but she just cannot appreciate the love he was demonstrating. As grandma is not likely to change, I wonder how to help him understand that his sweet but childish gifts are just not valuable to some people. If I say something, I'm concerned it will hurt him more in the long run. Personally, I love the pictures and letters and gifts he makes for me, and so does my mother, who lives far away. It makes me ache to see his compassionate gifts rejected to his face by a family member he loves. Your thoughts, sensitive mom of a sensitive boy. Here's what you can do. Just leave him alone in his sadness and rejection. Pain is a perfectly healthy emotion to absorb and feel. Okay, the world doesn't need more children who feel entitled to happy emotions. Don't dumb it down if you ask about it. It's perfectly fine to learn. Just let it happen. That's all I got to say for that one. Dear Abby, I'm facing major surgery in Seattle where my son and his wife live, 2,000 miles away from my home. After surgery, I must stay in town for 10 days until my post-op appointment. Then I'll be given the green light to travel home. During that period, my son will be working overseas and his wife plans to join him. Because their condo will be empty, I asked if my husband and I could stay there during my recovery. My son informed us that while we are welcome to stay there when they're in town, we are not welcome when they aren't. My son would never do this to us. I know it came from his wife. I also know that if the request were from her mother, she'd be welcome in a heartbeat. I have been nothing but generous and supportive of them. We aren't slobs and would care for the place as if it were our own. I just don't understand. How do I react? What can I say? My son's wife has isolated him from some of his friends too. Aching in Alaska. This is tricky. Because there's a couple things here. Your son's an asshole. His wife's an asshole. Or you're an asshole. And maybe all three might be true. Because this is the problem I have with what you said. So on the surface, it looks like your son's just a dick. You're facing surgery. You're her mother. You're his mother. They're going to have an empty apartment and they won't let you stay there. But they'll let you stay there while they are there. So clearly there's a trust issue somewhere. That's what that says to me. Why would they not let you stay while they're gone? That seems like a perfectly normal, loving thing a son would do for his mother, a daughter would do for the father, parents would do for their kids in a family that doesn't have a lot of dysfunction. That seems perfectly normal, especially considering the circumstances of your surgery, which you need help recovering from, 2,000 miles away from your home. To me, there's dysfunction in your family somehow. So when I say your son's an asshole, your wife's an asshole, or maybe you're an asshole, you know, kids have to learn it from somebody. Not always, but typically, if you raise your kids to be good human beings, you're not writing this email. But kids learn to be human beings from their parents. So that's why I say maybe you were an asshole too. What puzzles me is why he would let you come there while they're there. And then you gotta leave when they go. He's not trusting you about something. If you say you're clean, you're not a slob. Maybe the wife doesn't think you're gonna root through the drawers. Maybe the wife is the problem. I don't know. Well, there's another option here. Your son could just be a coward too, because the wife could be a dick and your son could be a coward, because if he's allowing his wife to tell him, no, your mother can't come after major surgery to recover here, and he wants her to, but he won't do it because the wife says, no, to me, that's being a coward. You stick up for your mother or a loved one who needs help in this situation. You know, I think it's okay if things happen like this. Okay. You're the husband and you say to the wife, honey, my mom just called. She wants to come over for dinner. What do you think? And the wife says, no. I don't want that. I'm not interested tonight. Okay. I'll tell mom. Mom, sorry. Can't do it tonight. That's perfectly okay. You know, if a wife or the other spouse or partner has an opinion that way. I've done that many times. Kelly's done that. That's normal for everybody. This isn't normal, though, to say you're 2,000 miles away from home, you're recovering from major surgery, we have an empty house, and you can't come. So I'm saying there's some dysfunction in there. And again, I think responsibility goes many ways. And you're probably partly responsible for his stance he's taken. That's the way I look at it. But I'm no genius, so you don't have to listen to any of this. Anyway, that's it for the Q&A. That was kind of interesting. We'll be back soon with a podcast between me and Kelly, episode number 4. Thank you for listening to this episode of Q&A. We'll talk to you soon.